Well, we're here in Joe Klein's orchard. These are some young trees of Sela on Gisela 5 that he planted 2 years ago. So he planted the first year, and these trees aren't irrigated, so they didn't grow a whole lot the first year. The tree came probably headed from the nursery, or Joe may have headed them at planting. And that first year, the only real significant growth he got was this much terminal growth. Maybe there were a few side branches, but Joe came in then the beginning of the second year, before bud break, and he selected buds, as we've talked about before, bud selection, leaving the terminal, not heading, that's very important, removing some buds below that terminal, leaving a bud, removing some buds, leaving a bud, removing, leaving, and he did that all the way down the tree. You can see the result of that was the first year, the tree, while it grew very little on the top, it established a good strong root system. And that allowed it to respond to the bud selection that he did prior to bud break in the second year. That response then throughout all of these very nice horizontal branches, I think we counted 13 or 14 branches on this tree. They are positioned very nicely in a whorl for the most part. And so going into the third year, he has a lot of opportunities to select the branches that he would like and eliminate any branches that are problematic. So while this tree looks beautiful, it's exactly where we want it to be, there's still some nice precision pruning that we can do to make it the best tree as it heads into its first crop. We see we will have some crop from the spurs on this tree. There's about 10 different spurs, and then we'll have a little bit of fruit at the base of each of these new shoots. So in the third year, he'll have a little bit of a crop here, and that's very important also to think about as we decide what branches to prune and how to prune. The tree at this point still is primarily leaves, so it's still a very strong tree with the ability to photosynthesize and put that carbon into new shoot growth. And you can see the branches on the tree from last year are very nice caliper, pencil size and larger. You got about 2 feet of growth on each of those, very uniform. That's because the tree had no crop to sap the strength and put it into the fruit. Now going into the third year, he's got some crop on the spurs and at the base of these shoots, and so he'll probably get about the same amount of growth next year. If he leaves his tree alone and doesn't worry about crop load, even though cropping is not a concern in the third year, but if he leaves it alone and doesn't think about his future crop in the fourth year, this tree will be overcropped in that fourth year. And when it's overcropped, his new growth will no longer be nice and 2 feet long and larger than pencil caliper, but it'll start decreasing as we've seen in some of our other orchard stops. And as it decreases, we get more and more crop on that tree. So now we're going to talk about pruning this tree, which is a very nice tree, but there's a couple of things with every tree we'll have that you'll want to try to correct each year. So because we have a number of branches that are whorled nicely, the first thing we can do is look for branches that overlap each other that would cause future shading. It's a little bit difficult to decide which branches to leave as the lowest branches on this tree because we're standing on at least about a foot of snow right now. And so this is not the time typically in Michigan that we would come and prune a young tree like this. We'd like to prune it when there's not the snow on the ground, and we can see if this lower branch is 2 feet off the ground, 3 feet off the ground, or whatever. So I'm going to make the assumption that these lowest branches at this time are still good. In the springtime, when we see where the ground really is, we make a different decision. But I can still make the decision on branches that might overlap each other, like these two, or like these two here. So at this point, taking a look at this tree, I like the uprightness of this branch. It's just about the minimum caliper that I want. Similar to this one, but it's a little more horizontal, maybe a little bit closer to the ground. So I can eliminate this branch entirely. That gives me no competition over here. Nice spacing between this one and the next one in the same orientation to allow good light back into the center canopy. Over here, I like the orientation of this branch. Directly over this one, it's a little bit stronger. They're both pretty close. So it's six of one, half a dozen of the other. Whichever one you choose would probably be okay. I see this one maybe tipping up a little bit more, so I'm going to go ahead and leave that one as the lowest one. So now I have a nice low tier. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Going out in every direction, cherry trees typically have a pattern of buds around them in a pattern of six that repeats itself. And so we probably have the right six buds as the lowest right lowest scaffolds. We look at the next tier of scaffolds then, and we're spaced out generally very nicely. We've got nice vigor on these branches. And so I'm going to leave all of these. We're not shading too much at this point, any of the rest of these branches. But that brings us to this one. This actually was a branch that was left on the tree the first year. And so it's not a new one that grew last year. This is last year's new growth. And you can see we have an acute angle, which we don't want, particularly in our climate, in a humid Great Lakes region. This is a prime location for bacterial canker. And so I want to eliminate this branch because it's at an acute angle. I want to eliminate it because it's about half the size of the diameter of the trunk, and so it's a little bit out of balance. It's not subordinately weak compared to the leader. And so I will take this one with a what we might call a bench cut, leaving a bit of a stub and leaving a bud below, which may grow out. It has some flower buds. I could knock those off come spring before they bloom, and that would give it perhaps a little more of an impetus to send a new vegetative bud out this way. So we've established the perfect bottom tier, established the second tier, we removed a problematic strong branch. We have one more problematic strong branch. We'll take that one out as well. Okay, so we identified this final strong branch. We've taken it off because the caliper, you can see, is very similar to the leader, so it's too strong, and the angle, which you probably can't see from the angle of the camera, is too acute. The angle was very acute and is another candidate for bacterial canker. So we eliminate this for both disease issues as well as to create new branches that will balance the tree and to not have challenging second leaders to this stronger terminal leader. So now we've eliminated all the problematic branches. The final thing we need to do is to tip these branches to establish further the structure of the tree as well as to start balancing the crop load.